Hello everyone and welcome to the video for section 9.7 on the rotation of axes. Our skill objectives for this particular video are one, to transform general second degree equations into recognizable equations of conics. Number two, determine the angle of rotation that will transform the general second degree equation. And number three, graph a rotated conic. So really what's going to happen on here, remember that when you have the term, the bxy term in that general equation, that tells you there's a rotation. So we're going to be going through and looking and using a substitution. We're going to replace the variable x and the variable y with an expression so that when we simplify that expression, that we're writing the equation in terms of a different axis. Okay, and then the conceptual objective, understand how the equation of a conic is altered by rotation of the axes. Okay, let's take a look at what really is going to be happening here. In this diagram, you see we have the x-axis here in black and the y-axis in black. Those are our standard axes. And then we've rotated these, the axes, so we have the red axes that are capital X and capital Y. That's how our book uses it. They use those capital X. Now, we've rotated the axes by an angle of theta, radians or degrees, however you want to look at it. And then there is another angle alpha here that goes between the rotated capital X axis and this line that connects a point P with the origin. And that point, that line has a length of R. Now, when we go on this problem here, if we take this, if we go from P and we drop a perpendicular, I create a right triangle. And here's that right here, here, there's our right angle right here, and there's the hypotenuse. The x coordinate is going to be this distance. It goes from the origin. It's going to tell me how far to the left or right I had to get moved to get to P. So our x value is here. The thing you have to remember from Sokotoa is that this x value that the cosine of this angle here of theta plus alpha, the cosine of that angle is x over r. And so what I have is that x is equal to r times the cosine of theta plus alpha if I just multiply it through. Okay, so remember in this case that the cosine of theta plus alpha is equal to x over r. And so when I multiply both sides by r, I get this expression that I have right here. Now, the cosine of a sum, we can break it up into this form here, that the cosine of, this is our sum, the cosine sum formula, cosine sum identity. So it's going to be r times the cosine of theta, cosine of alpha, minus sine of theta, sine of alpha. And if I distribute the r in, I get r cosine theta, cosine alpha, minus r sine theta, sine alpha. In this case, we also have that the sine of theta plus alpha is going to be the y coordinate over r. And so therefore, I get that y equals r sine of theta plus alpha. And when I use the sine sum formula, I get this. Now, the other thing I can do, because we have this rotated axis, okay, I can go and drop a line that's going to be perpendicular to the capital X axis. So right here. So in this case, this length from here to here, from the origin up to where the right angle hits, that is the capital X coordinate of that particular point. And we can find that because I know that the cosine of this alpha is going to be whatever capital X is over R, or therefore we have that capital X equals R cosine of alpha. And the same thing happens with the capital Y. Capital Y tells me how far above or below the capital X axis I got went. And so capital Y is equal to R sine of alpha. Now, this gives us a little bit of an insight in terms of what's going to happen. You see, because I could take this R here, and that can be paired with cosine of theta or cosine of alpha. And same with here, R could be paired with sine of theta or sine of alpha. And down here for the Y, R could be paired with either one of those or here. But what I'm going to do on this, I am going to go through and I'm going to let X is going to be cosine of theta times R cosine alpha minus sine theta times R sine alpha. And what that does though is this, I know that R cosine alpha and R sine alpha are capital X and Y. So I get that little x, my x coordinate, if you, or the x value, is going to be equal to capital X times the cosine of theta minus capital Y times the sine of theta. The same thing happens on this when I deal with the Y. If I go through, again, send that over here, I'm going to let R go with the alphas. So on this problem, I'm going to have that Y equals sine theta times R cosine alpha plus cosine theta R sine alpha. But again, I know that the R cosine alpha is equal to capital X, R sine alpha is equal to capital Y, and so I get that Y equals X, capital X, times the sine of theta plus capital Y times the cosine of theta. These two formulas that we have here, these are going to be the substitutions we're going to use in order to go and transform these equations. Okay. So right now what I have is that little x, the x that we usually work with is capital X cosine theta minus capital Y sine theta. And little y is capital X sine theta plus capital Y cosine theta. Well, I can go through and solve this for X and Y. What I can do here, I can go through and multiply. One thing I could do is multiply this top equation by cosine theta, multiply the bottom equation by sine of theta, and then when I go through and I can use that to solve these things. And then I could do the top equation by sine of theta, bottom equation by cosine theta, and I could do the same thing. So what ends up happening here is that I can take this system here, solve it for capital X and capital Y, and I get these two here as well. These two that you have here are going to be ones you're going to want to be aware of, because one of the things we're going to do is we're going to look and saying, okay, if I take a point and I rotate it through an angle, rotate the axes around an angle, and we create remember, when we do that rotation, we're creating a new axis system. Well, because we have that new axis system, there is going to be a new coordinates in with respect to those particular axes that we're going to want to use. So this right here is going to be what we're going to do when we rotate those points. So in this case, in this example here, we have the point 3, negative 4, and we want to rotate it 30 degrees. So using these equations here, I know that capital X is equal to the X coordinate times the cosine of the angle of rotation, plus Y times the sine of the angle of rotation. So in this case, capital X is going to be the X coordinate, which is 3, times the cosine of 30 degrees, plus the negative 4 times the sine of 30 degrees. Well, cosine of 30 degrees is square root 3 over 2. Sine of 30 degrees is 1 half. So this expression here becomes 3 square root of 3 over 2 minus 2. Because negative 4 times 1 half would be negative 2. And when I put that in the calculator, I'm going to come up with that my capital X coordinate of this point on our new axis system is going to be 0.598. Capital Y coordinate, using the same relationship, the opposite of X times the sine of the angle of rotation, plus y times the cosine of the angle of rotation. So in this case, y is negative 3 times the sine of 30 degrees. Remember, it's 3, so it's the opposite of that, plus negative 4 times the cosine of 30 degrees. Again, sine of 30 degrees is 1 half. Cosine is square root 3 over 2. So this becomes negative 3 over 2 minus 4 square root of 3 over 2. And again, if you put this into your calculator, you're going to come up with something about negative 4.964. Let's take a visualization of this particular problem, what's actually happening here. So in this case, I have the axes. There's x, here's y. And if I go over 1, 2, 3, and down 1, 2, 3, 4, there's our point. That's the point 3, negative 4. Now I'm going to rotate my axes 30 degrees. So 30 degrees, when I rotate it, it's going to be about here. And I do the same thing. This is our capital X axis. And I do the same thing off of the Y. So we have that. So now, remember, this capital X coordinate tells you, and again, that's capital Y, that capital X coordinate tells you how far away from the capital Y axis we're going to be. And you notice that we're pretty close there. Now, again, you got to keep in mind, this is freehand, so there's a little bit of error there that's going to be associated with this. And then the capital Y coordinate tells me a distance that you are from the capital X axis. So you can see that comes out to be, it makes sense that it would be a negative 4.9, about negative 5 units away. Now let's take a look at the angle of rotation. One of the things in terms of going through and doing all this, you know, the substitutions we have involve that angle. We have to know what the angle of rotation is. So when I have a conic, a general conic, the ax squared plus bxy plus cy squared plus dx plus ey plus f equals 0, I want to go and change this into an equation in capital X and capital Y without any xy term. That's the key thing. We don't want to have an xy term. So I can then go through and say, okay, this is standard form. I can then graph it on that new capital X, capital Y axes, just as I normally do when I'm on the ones that we did without the rotation. So one of the things we have here is that when we have this, we rotate the X and Y axes by an acute angle theta such that it satisfies this equation here, that the cotangent of 2 theta is a minus c over b, or if you prefer, the tangent of 2 theta is b over a minus c. For example, let's look at this equation here. 4x squared plus the square root of 3 times xy plus 3y squared minus 1 equals 0. I want to take this one. I need to determine the angle of rotation. Well, I can do one of two things. I can do the fact that the cotangent is going to be, in this case, a is 4, c is 3, b is square root of 3. So I can say the cotangent of 2 theta is 4 minus 3, which would be 1 over the square root of 3. Or I could use the fact that the tangent of 2 theta comes out to be square root of 3 over 1. Either one, it doesn't matter. You might be more familiar with this one just because that's the one we worked with mostly. With the tangents, you know, that's also, we have an inverse tangent key on our calculator. But in this case, that means that 2 theta, the tangent is equal to square root of 3 over 1, or the cotangent is 1 over square root of 3, when the angle that's inside the trig function equals 30 degrees is equal to 60 degrees or pi over 3. So 2 theta is 60 degrees or pi over 3. And so what I have to do is solve for theta. That's our actual angle of rotation. And in this case, our angle of rotation comes out to be 30 degrees or pi over 6. Again, you can work with radians or degrees on this. I'm not going to make a big deal about it. Whichever one you feel most comfortable with. Take a minute, look at my calculations, make sure you're comfortable with this. In the next slide, you are going to have to go through and pause this video, make sure you're comfortable with all the different calculations, because in the next slide, you're going to see that there's a lot of calculations that took place. We're going to make a substitution. We're going to use this same equation right here. We're going to find a substitution for x and for the y, and then we're going to have to multiply all this out. So make sure you're comfortable with this right now, and once you're ready, let's go on to the next slide. All right, now you're going to see this is a real complicated looking slide, but let's go through this. We're going to start out here. We're going to rewrite this equation in capital X and capital Y, okay? So we're starting out with that 4x squared plus square root of 3xy plus 3y squared minus 1 equals 0. Now, remember our substitutions, okay? In this problem, you want to remember that x is always equal to, that little x is always equal to capital X times the cosine of theta minus capital Y sine of that angle of rotation. That's our substitution. That's the little x. And little y is equal to capital X sine of our angle of rotation plus capital Y cosine of that angle of rotation. So what you see over here in red, this is my substitution I'm going to use for little x. I know little x equals our angle of rotation. What we saw in the previous slide was that the angle of rotation was 30 degrees. So little x is going to be capital X times the cosine of 30 degrees minus capital Y times the sine of 30 degrees, which cosine of 30 degrees is square root 3 over 2. Sine of 30 degrees is 1/2. So this expression becomes this. Capital X times square root 3 over 2 minus capital Y divided by 2. Now, one thing I'm going to tell you you're going to want to do, you're going to want to simplify this. Now, I pulled out a factor of 1/2. So this right here is equal to 1/2 times, that's a capital X square root of 3 minus capital Y. Okay? Make sure you treat that as that capital X. So let me make that a little bit bigger. There we go. The same thing happens on this with the little y. Y is equal to capital X times the sine of my angle, which is 30 degrees, plus capital Y times the cosine of that 30 degrees. And again, sine is 1/2, sine of 30 degrees is 1/2, cosine of 30 degrees is square root 3 over 2. And so this becomes x times 1/2, or x over 2, plus y times the square root of 3 over 2. And like I did up here, I pulled out the 1/2. And so this expression here is 1/2 times capital X plus capital Y times the square root of 3. Now I want you right now, pause the video, make sure you're comfortable with everything I've done here, because this part here is going to be key moving forward. Okay, now we have this expression right here. This is our equation. Now the only thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take that 1 and I'm going to take it to the other side. So I have 4x squared plus square root of 3 times xy plus 3y squared equals 1. And now what I'm going to do, and you'll see that I did this in terms of colors, I am going to replace the x here with this expression, the 1/2 times the quantity x square root of 3, capital X square root of 3 minus capital Y. And I'm going to replace the y's with 1/2 times the quantity capital X plus capital Y times the square root of 3. So here I have the 4 times my expression I have for x. So I have the 1/2 times that capital X squared of 3 minus capital Y, that whole thing squared, plus I replace the x with its expression, and then I replace the y with its expression, and then I have plus 3 times 1/2 times capital X plus capital Y squared of 3, that whole thing squared. And that equals 1. Now the next thing I did here is I just kind of moved things around a little bit. I dealt with the squarings and the multiplying the coefficients here. So in this case, when I had to square the 1/2, that's going to give me 1/4 times that quantity here squared. Now here, this 1/2 and that 1/2 multiply together to be 1/4 times the x times the y, what little x and little y were equal to. Capital X squared of 3 minus capital Y times capital X plus capital Y squared of 3. And then plus 3, and then same thing here. We have the square. 1 half squared is 1 fourth times that quantity squared. That equals 1. Now, we have to go through, multiply these out. So, the 4 times the 1 fourth here, these will cancel each other out. So that's gone. So what I have here is I have to FOIL capital X squared of 3 minus Y times capital X squared of 3 minus Y. And when I do that, I will get 3 times capital X squared minus 2 times the square root of 3 times capital X times capital Y plus capital Y squared. Again, if you're not sure about this, pause the video, take this particular expression, capital X squared of 3 minus Y times capital X squared of 3 minus Y, and FOIL that. You should end up with this. As we move forward, the square root of 3 times the 1 fourth will give me square root of 3 over 4. And then when I FOIL this out, now this time, in terms of this, I'll have the capital X square root of 3 times capital X will give me capital X squared times the square root of 3. Then I'm going to take capital X square root of 3 times capital Y square root of 3. Well, the square root of 3 times square root of 3 will make that a 3 times capital X capital Y minus capital X times capital Y, and then minus capital Y squared times the square root of 3. So when I FOIL this expression in purple out, remember that 1 fourth is with the square root of 3, that here will become this. Now these two here combine. Those two combine to be 2 times capital X times capital Y. So those two take care of each other, and that will become that. And then we deal with the 3 fourths, and I have to do the same thing here. I have capital X plus capital Y square root of 3, and I have to square that. So when I write that out, capital X plus capital Y square root of 3 times capital X plus capital Y square root of 3, and FOIL, I will end up with capital X squared plus 2 times the square root of 3 times capital X times capital Y plus 3 times capital Y squared, and everything there equals 1. Now again, I want you to pause the video, make sure you're comfortable with the algebra that I've done to go from this expression here down to our third line. If you're comfortable, once you're comfortable with that, come back and we'll finish this one up. Okay, now what I'm going to do at this point is I am going to go distribute this square root of 3 over 4 and the 3 fourths inside. And already, the thing, keep in mind, I know I'm going to end up with some fractions here, okay? And so what I'm going to do, especially because of the XY terms, capital X, capital Y terms, these should drop out. I will know I'm in a good spot if those drop out. So I'm going to go through, I already know I'm going to end up with a denominator of 4. So I'm going to write all the terms, especially this one here, as a denominator of 4. So that will be 3x squared minus 2 square root of 3x capital X capital Y will be minus 8 times the square root of 3 over 4 times capital X capital Y when I get that common denominator, plus the Y squared, plus 3 fourths X squared, plus 2 times square root of 3 over 4 times capital X times capital Y. And then when I distribute this square root of 3 over 4 to this, to the Y squared square root of 3, capital Y squared square root of 3, I got the square root of 3. So that's going to end up being minus 3 fourths times capital Y squared. And when I distribute the 3 fourths in here, I'll get 3 fourths capital X squared plus 6 square root of 3 over 4 capital X capital Y plus 9 over 4 capital Y squared, and everything there equals 1. Now at this point, I do a quick check because I know if I've done this right, these terms that I have with the XY terms should end up dropping off. Well, you'll notice here, I have in this case 2 square roots of 3 over 4 capital X capital Y plus 6 square root of 3 over 4, capital X, capital Y. When I add those two together, those like terms, I may get 8 times the square root of 3 over 4 times capital X, capital Y, and I have minus 8 square root of 3 over 4, capital X, capital Y. So what happens here is all of these XY terms, end up canceling each other out. And I'm left then with just the capital X squared and capital Y squared terms. I don't have any other terms I have to deal with. So I have 3 times capital X squared plus Y squared plus 3/4 capital X squared minus 3/4 Y squared plus 3/4 capital X squared plus 9/4 capital Y squared equals 1. Getting common denominators and combining things, I get that this will be 12 over 4 capital X squared plus 4 over 4 capital Y squared plus 3 over 4 capital X squared minus 3 over 4 capital Y squared plus 3/4 capital X squared plus 9/4 capital Y squared. I just got everything with a denominator of 4 and combined them. Well, the 12 over 4 plus 3 over 4 plus another 3 over 4 gives me 18 over 4 capital X squared. And then the 4 over 4 minus 3/4 plus 9/4 gives me 10/4 capital Y squared equals 1. Or I now have that this is going to be 9 over 2 X squared plus 5 over 2 Y squared equals 1. And this is an ellipse. We recognize that as an ellipse already. And if I was to write that in its standard form, I've had X squared over 2/9 plus capital Y squared over 2/5, and that equals 1. So in this case, A comes out to be the A squared is 2 over 5 because 2/5 is bigger than 2/9, and B is the B squared is 2/9 on this one. This is an ellipse. The center of this is at 0, 0. We can go through. We know that we have to move square root of 2/5 off of 0, 0 to get to the vertices. So this is going to be a very small ellipse, and we have to move square root of 2/9 off of the going left and right to get to the endpoints of the minor axis. It's going to be a vertical major axis, and we can get a good sketch of that ellipse. Okay, so take a look. Pause the video. Make sure, look over those calculations. There's a lot on here. You do need to be careful of signs, S-I-G-Ns. Okay, sign mistakes can cause major problems on this, so be very diligent with those. The nice thing is the angles of rotation are generally going to be acute angles, so we're going to be in decent shape with that. And then hopefully that as we move forward, that you're more comfortable with these and that you're able to be careful with these. So with that, we will have some time on Thursday and Friday to work on these in class. Otherwise, I hope you're having a good week, and we'll see you in class.